This
is on top
conference
of
will now be recorded.
So I'll change it to today because I'm answering work tomorrow. And is this topic is over to you? Intestinal obstruction?
No, sir.
No, sir.
No? But some people are telling that they have told intestinal obstruction. But anyway, because we are telling everything about the small bowel, so we have finished anatomy, physiology, and little embryology, Crohn's disease, intussusception, knuckles, all those things. But the last chapter with small intestine is, and very important, small intestinal obstruction. It is very difficult to ask the essay question. So let us start this. Small intestinal obstruction, of course. So obstruction of the intestine is a blockage that completely stops or seriously impedes the passage of intestinal contents from proximal to distal. So that is the normal course of intestinal passage of the intestinal contents, starting from stomach to the rectum and anal canal, that will be obstructed. The process will be obliterated or blocked due to various reasons. So this intestinal obstruction, the classification, you can leisurely go through this diagram: small bowel obstruction, large bowel obstruction, dynamic obstruction, adynamic obstruction, complete obstruction, simple obstruction, or strangulated obstruction, acute obstruction or chronic obstruction, dynamic and adynamic. So these are the various types of intestinal obstruction you come across. And what is the most common intestinal obstruction? Can anybody tell? Of all the things, what is the most common? What is the most common intestinal obstruction? Dynamic, adynamic, complete, incomplete, acute, chronic, simple, strangulated. So many things are there. What is the common? So dynamic obstruction is common. Remember, dynamic obstruction is the commonest intestinal obstruction. That means it will have some, it will have some causative agent for causing the obstruction, that is the passage of the contents in the, of course. And in majority of the cases, and of course, what is the common cause of adynamic obstruction? Last time I told you, what is the other name for adynamic obstruction?
Paralytic ileus.
Very good, paralytic ileus. What is the common cause?
Surgery.
Yes, post-operative, any operations on the abdomen will be leading to adynamic or paralytic ileus. So complete, incomplete. So the lumen is completely blocked or incomplete. Acute or chronic obstruction, or subacute obstruction, or acute and chronic obstruction. So simple obstruction means that the bowel is viable, and strangulated obstruction means that the bowel is not viable. So these are the some of the definitions, and all the intestinal obstructions will go under these classifications. Say, for example, what is the type of intestinal obstruction we have discussed? In small intestine topics, what type of intestinal obstruction? What is the special type of intestinal obstruction?
Volvulus.
The dynamic of. Volvulus have we discussed?
No.
Yes, volvulus is also a dynamic obstruction, but what is the type of intestinal obstruction we have discussed? Intussusception is common in from small intestine to ileal or ileocolic, whereas volvulus is common in sigmoid colon. That we will usually discuss in special types of intestinal obstruction or in the chapters of colon. Okay. And what is the type of, what is the cause for what is the type of intestinal obstruction in Crohn's disease? Also we have discussed. What is the cause for intestinal obstruction in Crohn's disease? So I am giving you the presentations also. You are having a lot of leisure time. You must do. Chapandi. Strictures. Strictures of the small intestine is very common in Crohn's disease because it involves the entire all the layers of the intestine. Okay, it is a transmural, so it involves all the layers, and there will be a lot of fibrosis and stricture formation and fistula formation, irregular band formation, all those abscess formation in Crohn's disease. All those things will lead to intestinal obstruction or perforation of a chronic Crohn's ulcer. Though it is there, it can occur. So all these things we have already discussed in some of the diseases. So all these things put together, the topic is intestinal obstruction. So these are the. Okay, these are the causes of intestinal obstruction. So, because we have discussed so many types, the main types are dynamic and aerodynamic. So, in dynamic means there will be a mechanical cause for the obstruction to occur. So, in the bowel, the either intraluminal causes like fecal impaction or impaction by the food particles, foreign bodies, or worms, bezoars, gallstone ileus. All these things will cause dynamic, intraluminal cause of dynamic obstruction. Intramural, that is within the wall of the, within the wall of the intestine. That is stricture, which is very common in Crohn's disease and tuberculosis. And malignancy, tumors of the small intestine can cause, suppose there is a lipoma, submucous lipoma is there. What it causes usually? Submucous lipoma of the small intestine. It is a leading point for the intussusception.
Intussusception.
Likewise, Meckel's diverticulum is also sometimes it is a leading cause for the intussusception to occur. So all these things we have already discussed. They are the intramural causes, stricture and tumors of the small intestine. And extramural, that is bands and adhesions, hernia, volvulus, intussusception, and what are the other things? Extramural. Hernia, neoplasms, and abscesses. So, of all the things, because we have seen so many things as a causative agent for dynamic obstruction, I already told you the commonest cause is, what is the commonest cause? Spinorhizin. Adhesions and bands. Adhesions and bands, postoperative adhesions is the commonest cause of intestinal obstruction. Of all the things, and the aerodynamic obstruction is also common because of the paralytic ileus. So all these aerodynamic obstruction due to paralytic ileus due to in postoperative cases, mesenteric vascular occlusion, pseudo obstruction due to various causes. It is a type of paralytic ileus only that also we will discuss in due course. So these are the causes of intestinal. So of all the causes, the commonest cause, okay, we'll see in the next slide. So this is the common causes of intestinal obstruction age wise. So at the birth, like atresia of the duodenum or ileum, congenital atresia, so congenital narrowing, meconium obstruction, valvulus neonatorum. So at around 3 weeks of age, congenital hypertrophic pyloric stenosis. Stomach lo chepara mikindi congenital hypertrophic pyloric stenosis. Chepara ma stomach chepinappudu.
ఇంకా ఇప్పుడు చెప్తారు సార్ స్టమక్ లో
చెప్పారా దాని వాట్ ఈస్ ద ట్రీట్మెంట్ ఫర్ దిస్ కంజంక్షన్
చెప్తారు సార్ ఇంకా చెప్పలేదు సార్
చెప్పలేదు ఓకే రైట్ ఓకే 6 to 9 months ఇంటర్సెప్షన్ సి అవర్ ఇంటర్సెప్షన్ ఇస్ అస్ కామన్ సో ఇట్ ఇస్ కామన్ ఇన్ ఇన్ఫెంట్స్ అండ్ చిల్డ్రన్ ఇంటర్సెప్షన్ సో ఇన్ టీనేజెస్ పీపుల్ ఇన్ఫ్లమేటరీ మాసెస్ లైక్ అపెండిసైటిస్ ఇంటర్సెప్షన్ ఆఫ్ మెకల్స్ డైవర్టికులం ఆర్ ఎ పాలీ And in young adults, like hernia and adhesions. And in adults, hernia, adhesions, and appendicitis, Crohn's disease, and tumors and in elderly carcinoma, diverticulitis and sigmoid volvulus. So this is as a clue, depending on the age, the common causes has been given in this table. So this is one line about the epidemiology. In Western countries, the causes have been changing. In the early part of the 20th century, the most common cause was obstructed hernia. So before this new era, early part of the 20th century, obstructed hernia. So the inguinal hernia or some other hernia is getting obstructed because of the negligence. So that was the usually that was the common cause. But now post-operative adhesions are the leading cause. Post-operative adhesions. You remember this point. Earlier, hernias, obstructive hernias is the common. Now it is the post-operative adhesions. And in Africa and India, for example, in the underdeveloped countries, volvulus of the small intestine, obstructive hernias again in our countries, intussusception, and recurrent intestinal obstruction is developing due to tuberculosis. Whereas in Western world, bronchial disease is common. Whereas in our country, in African tropical countries, tuberculosis is common cause, which mimics bronchial disease in many aspects. It also gives rise to coagulation and cases in necrosis and strictures. Whereas in France also, there will be strictures, which is common in Western countries, whereas in English. So the earlier the obstructed hernia was the commonest cause of intestinal obstruction. Now the trend is changing towards the post-operative adhesions because so many patients are undergoing operations. So after operation, they are likely to develop adhesions, which is the leading cause of intestinal obstruction. So this is from Bailey and Love. You can see. 40% of the cases are due to adhesions, 40, and 15 is due to tumors, carcinomas, and around 12 is due to obstructed hernia, and this inflammatory, that means Crohn's and tuberculosis around 15, and other causes like fecal impaction, pseudo obstruction, and other miscellaneous causes, this around 18%, all put together 18%. So by this pie chart, you can say that the obstruction, adhesions is the leading cause. Adhesions is the leading cause. And second common cause is carcinoma. And third common cause is hernia. And fourth one is inflammatory. And the other causes are fifth one, miscellaneous and fecal impaction. So always remember, this is from Bailey and Love. Whereas this is from Sabiston. In that book, he says 60% is due to adhesions. 60% are due to adhesions. So in that 40%, but here in Sabiston latest edition, he has given us 60%. 20% are due to tumors. 10% are due to hernias. 5% are due to inflammatory form, because Crohn's is very common in Western world. And 5% are miscellaneous, like fecal impaction, pseudo obstructions, and all those things. So by any means, adhesions is the leading cause of small bowel obstruction, intestinal obstruction, and in 40 to 60% of cases, and in 15 to 20% it is tumors, and in 10 to 15% it is hernias, and in 5% it is inflammatory diseases. In Western countries it is Crohn's. And in India and other tropical countries, it is tuberculosis, and 5% are miscellaneous. So this is, you must remember each and every word of this topic, because it is frequently asked as a question. So what happens to the pathophysiology, irrespective of the etiology of or acuteness of the onset, in dynamic obstruction. Dynamic means there is a mechanical cause for the obstruction. Above the obstruction, the bowel shows hyperperistalsis above the obstruction. So that means proximal to the obstruction, there will be bowel shows hyperperistalsis. If the obstruction is not relieved, the bowel continues to dilate, resulting in reduction of peristaltic strength, resulting in flaccidity and paralysis. So this is above the obstruction. And below the obstruction, it exhibits normal peristalsis and absorption until it becomes empty and collapses. So the distension of proximal to obstruction caused by, so the distension of obstruction is caused by gas. What is the cause for distension of the bowels? It is mainly due to gas, due to significant overgrowth of both aerobic and anaerobic bacteria and swallowed air and all those things, everything will be there. And fluids is normally secreted or ingested saliva, secreted contains gastric contents, bile, pancreatic juices, and intestinal secretions and all those things. And moreover, the absorption will be, the secretions are normal, but the absorption from the obstructed bowel will be decreased. So there will be stasis in the bowel. So this is obstruction, accumulation of gas and fluid, distension, increased intestinal content, intestinal secretion, decreased absorption, that is the main pathology. Increased accumulation, vomiting will be there. And finally, the patient will have dehydration and metabolic disturbances like hypokalemia and metabolic alkalosis. And finally, algorrhea, hemoconcentration, and azotemia. Azotemia, reduced CO, reduced carbon dioxide tension, low CVP, hypotension, and hypovolemic shock. So this is the pathophysiology of the how the obstruction causes all these symptoms. But it all depends on the level of obstruction. Very some minor things may be happening in case of, depending on the level of the obstruction. That we will see in the next. You see, everyday many of the gastrointestinal tract, such as saliva, 1.5 liters, gastric juice, 1.8 liters, pancreatic juice around 1 liter, intestinal around 2 to 4 liters. So all these things will be normally secreted, starting from the saliva, from the up to the small intestine. But most of them are absorbed within the, from the small intestine itself. Most of them. So say this is around 9 to 10 liters. So around 9 liters will be absorbed from the small intestine. Okay. Only 1.5 liters are ejected into the large intestine, where the remaining fluid and electrolytes are absorbed from the large intestine also, leaving only 100 to 200 ml of water, of fecal matter, which is excreted. So all these fluids are accumulated in the small bowel, the obstructed bowel. So this is it called third space volume. Third space, and it will not participate in circulation. And so much of fluid is accumulated in the intestinal obstruction, which is obstructed, diseased. So, and that means there is no proper absorption in there. So, what type of shock the patient will have? Same shock to the mind, the fluid can be both.
Hypovolemic shock.
So, the patient will have hypovolemic shock. So that is the characteristic of acute intestinal obstruction. The, that is mainly the dynamic intestinal. Therefore, the intravascular fluid volume is depleted. There is a reduction in the extracellular fluid volume due to continuing losses owing to vomiting and defective absorption. So the intestinal contents are not properly absorbed, and moreover, because of the distension, there will be a lot of vomiting. If the ongoing loss of intestinal secretions into the lumen of the bowel is called is a third space loss. That means which is not participating in the circulation. Fluid depletion is severe and occurs early in high small intestinal obstruction. So the higher the small intestinal obstruction, the vomitings accumulation will be the more in proximal obstruction. That we will discuss now. So Broadly speaking, the types are, because we have discussed so many types, but mainly we are concentrating on the bowel obstruction, high or low type, and large bowel obstruction. See, for example, proximal obstruction. That means the obstruction is in the proximal part of the gastrointestinal tract. So that is almost in the proximal jejunum. See, this is the proximal jejunum. That means all these contents will be through. There will be vomiting will be first, because all the secretions, because by the time the proximal jejunum is obstructed, the stomach contains the saliva, the pancreatic juice, the bile juice, everything, and some of the secretions from the intestine, all will be accumulated and they will be vomited. And abdomen not very much distended, because the abdomen is, because the obstruction is very high above, and intermittent pain, but not of colic. But not of quality type. And if it is mid-intestinal, so somewhere in between the junction of the jejunum and the ileum, or lower part of the jejunum, not so frequent vomiting, abdomen moderately distended, and intermittent colicky pain will be there. And if it is in the low intestinal obstruction, that is the terminal ileum, or in the early colon, so vomiting occurs very late, because all these bowel, the length of the bowel is around 800 centimeters, 400 to 800 centimeters, 2 to 3 to 6 feet. So all these things must be dilated before the patient gets vomited. So vomiting occurs late. If vomiting present, it will become feculent, because it is from the lower part of the ileum, which by that time it is almost feculent to water. And marked abdominal distension, because of the entire small bowel is proximal to the obstruction, everything is distended. And abdominal pain, not classic crescendo type. There will be abdominal pain. Of course, there may be it may be more, or it may be of colicky. But colicky is very typical if it is in the mid intestinal portion of the small bowel. So this is the intestinal differences between small bowel and large bowel obstruction. You can easily understand by looking at this, and in the leisure time you can read calmly and carefully. You can site of pain periumbilical if it is large bowel, intraumbilical, that is a hypogastrium, vomiting early, frequent and profuse in case of small bowel, and in large bowel late or maybe absent. And colics are very frequent in small bowel and they are delayed in large bowel. Constipation and obstipation are very late in small bowel. In large bowel, they are very early. And abdominal distance is central and early, and in large bowel, it is generalized and late. Dehydration and shock are very marked and early in case of small bowel, because of the frequent vomitings. Okay? Because of the frequent vomitings, profuse, early, frequent vomitings, the dehydration or shock are very early in case of small bowel obstruction and compared to large bowel obstruction. Of course, this is a radiograph, small and large bowel obstruction. Suppose you take the x-ray, it will give you a clue that the diameter of the small bowel is a little less than 2.5 centimeters. You see the small bowel looks, the diameter is about 2.5, less than 3 centimeters, like that. And because it is, most of the small intestine will have valvular condensation, especially in the jejunum. And if it is large bowel, you can see radiologically it is wide, very luminous. The diameter will be more than 5 centimeters. And there will be obstructions, and presence of solid fecal matter might be present. Whereas in this small bowel, all these things will not be there, and there will be only valvular convent diameter will be less, and valvular convent is will might be present. Whereas if it is large bowel, diameter will be more and there will be obstructions. So all these are the differences between small bowel and large bowel obstructions. In the previous slide, we have discussed the clinical features. There is clinical features. This is the x-ray differences. So the obstruction can be present as acute, chronic, acute and chronic, or subacute. Because all of these things can be simple. That is, blood supply of the intestine that is affected is intact or strangulated. Strangulated means blood supply is obstructed or jeopardized or cut off. The common causes are obstructed hernia, which has turned into strangulated hernia, and bands and adhesions. Bands and adhesions in the beginning they give rise to normal. I mean, that means a simple obstruction. But if it is neglected, the simple obstruction, it has not been tackled as early as possible, it may go for strangulation. Okay. Strangulation means nothing but the blood supply will not be, the blood supply will not be present, that means it will be cut off. So coming to the clinical features of intestinal obstruction, the four cardinal features of acute intestinal obstruction are abdominal pain, vomiting, distension, and absolute constipation. These are the four cardinal features. And my favorite question, as in Japan, in examination, what will be there on inspection? In intestinal obstruction and inspection, there will be
reverse
distension. Distension will be there, visible intestinal peristalsis of stepladder and bite might be there. Palpation, the abdomen is tense. There will not be any tender unless it is strangulated. On percussion, it is resonant. On auscultation, hyper.
Bowel sounds will be more.
Increased bowel sounds will be heard. Okay. Gaba gaba gurtu pettukovali anamata aa topic ranga. For example, peritonitis rangalni enti, appendicitis rangalni enti, ee intestinal obstruction rangalni oka 4 points in the examination gurtu pettukovali, right? So coming to the abdominal pain, the first symptom sudden and severe, it is of colicky nature. You can read afterwards. With increasing distension, colic pain is replaced by mild or moderate constant diffuse pain. So in the beginning, because the pain will be very severe, because the increased peristalsis, the proximal bowel will attempt to propel the contents, overcome the obstruction, so there will be vigorous peristalsis. But as the time goes on, the intestines will become weak. And they will be paralyzed, giving rise to dull aching pain. And if there is no ischemia, the obstruction persists for over several days and pain reduces and can disappear. That means it has become chronic obstruction. In this case, it has become chronic obstruction. Okay. If there is no ischemia, severe pain is suggestive of strangulation, especially when it is severe continuous pain, is suggestive of strangulation. Why there is severe continuous pain? Because the blood supply is cut off. What happens in strangulation? The patient will be toxic. There will be an endotoxic shock. Septic shock will be there in strangulated intestinal obstruction. And there may be damage to the bowel wall and rupture, and there may be perforation, giving way of those bowels giving rise to peritonitis. So all these things are the sequences of strangulated bowel. So the strangulated bowel means loss of blood supply. So it will not keep quiet. Once the blood supply is lost, it gets necrosed or it may perforate or it may give rise to toxemia and shock because of the bacteria that can be translocated into the systemic circulation. So vomiting, the more distal the obstruction, the longer the interval between the onset. So the proximal the obstruction, the more will be profuse and early the vomitings. As obstruction progresses, the character of the vomiters alters. So for example, early jejunum undanukondi. So from food material to feculent material. Cheppanu kada, if it is proximal part of the jejunum, only the bile and food particles, gastric contents, saliva will come out. If it is a terminal ileum, say for example due to gallstone ileus, are stuck at the ileocecal junction, so the vomitus can contain fecal matter also, feculent material also. Okay, that also you have to remember. The quality of the vomitus and the quantity of the vomiting will depend on the site and cause of the obstruction. And constipation, usually in the beginning there will be constipation for what? Feces. Yeah, the patient will pass for some time because distal to the obstruction. So intestinal obstruction, they are distal to the obstruction. That means, for example, there is obstruction the ileocecal junction. So what is there in the distal to the obstruction? What is there distal to the obstruction?
Cecum.
Yes, cecum and the entire cola. So it will be having some amount of gas and all those something. So early you get passes of some and some flat. So once that distal bubble is also empty, there will be not passing either breaking or so that and the rule that absolute constipation in intestinal obstruction does not apply in rectus. Sir, what is rectus?
Only a part of the bowel when it gets into the perineal sac.
Part of the surface. Okay. But this part is the occlusion and obstruction associated with gallstone injury. In all these cases, there may not be constipation or obstruction, may be present or may not be present. You remember this one. And especially this distension is mainly, I told you, it is mainly due to that fluid and gas. Gas is from sphalerite and from the bacteria, both aerobic and bacteria, they produce a lot of gas. And the patient swallows a lot of air also because of the apprehension, because the air that is normally swallowed into the bowel also will not get absorbed. It will give rise to distension. And finally, the patient, see on inspection, there will be visible peristalsis. On flicking the abdomen, you can see the visible peristalsis. It is characteristic of small intestinal obstruction. It is of step ladder pattern, VIP, visible intestinal peristalsis. Of course, it may not be seen in all the cases, but in majority of the cases, it can be seen. Of course, the distension is due to gases, fluids collected in the and no absorption. This is the main cause. These are the causes for dilatation of distension of the bowels. See, this is the step ladder pattern of visible intestinal peristalsis. See, the patient is having femoral hernia, arrow. So femoral hernias are notorious for obstructions. So the femoral hernia, it has caused obstruction, so it is obstructed femoral hernia causing intestinal obstruction. So what is the treatment? It is not the treatment of opening the abdomen. It is the repair of the femoral hernia. So the treatment also depending on the cause. So, for example, I am telling you. So this is a classical step ladder pattern of visible intestinal hernia. Very rarely you will be able to see such cases. And late manifestations of intestinal obstruction are the systemic effects include elevation of the diaphragm because of the distension, there will be restricted ventilation and subsequent lung atelectasis, and impaired venous return because the sequestration of the fluid into the intestinal, the obstructed bowels. Because I told you it is a third space volume which will not participate in the circulation. So impaired venous return, it may lead to decreased cardiac output. And the loss of fluids and alkalis are very important because all the proximal to the intestinal obstruction, all the bowel contents including starting from saliva, stomach, bile, pancreas, intestines, everything will be vomited out. So it causes a lot of viscosity, the blood being viscosity will be increased, hypovolemia, renal insufficiency, electrolyte disturbances, like if it is from the stomach and early duodenum. So if it is from the stomach, acid will be vomited. So the patient will go into alkalosis like that. So a lot of electrolyte and metabolic disturbances will occur, and it will give rise to hypovolemic shock, and if not properly treated, give rise to death. Whereas shock may be accelerated by bacteria and their toxins in strangulated obstruction. So this is mainly in the non-strangulated, simple obstruction. Mechanical but simple, that means the blood supply is intact. Suppose when the blood supply of the small intestine is lost, so the bowel will get strangulated, necrosed, and there will be altered microbial flora. And there may be toxins that are released from them will enter into circulation. So once it is strangulated, it will give rise to toxic shock or septic shock. So before that, it is hypovolemic shock. Once it is strangulated, it is toxic shock. So that is about the acute obstruction. In chronic obstructions, usually seen in large bowel, lower abdominal pain will be there, constipation, and some amount of distension will be present. And acute and chronic means, that means there is a chronic obstruction due to, for example, a Crohn stricture is there. So over the Crohn stricture, some foreign body or some footballers or some worms, they may get, and they will precipitate the chronic obstruction into the acute attack. So acute and chronic obstruction. So short history of distension and vomiting, and long standing pain and constipation. That means chronic will be there over which it is superimposed. That is acute and chronic obstruction. And subacute obstruction, it is also very common, frequently, and whether if not acute obstruction, we usually diagnose as subacute intestinal obstruction, where the constipation will be incomplete. So the patient passes some amount of fecal matter. So the obstruction is not complete and not acute. Okay, so when the patient has not passed motion or gas for 2 or 3 days, but there are no vomitings, but there will be some amount of distension. So we usually call it as subacute obstruction, which we treat. Subacute obstruction will be treated by conservative manner, usually. So if it is not, and usually it gets subsided with conservative manner. And if our diagnosis is wrong, it may precipitate, it may become acute or chronic. So only by investigations, we have to confirm whether it is non-problematic subacute obstruction, or it may be a problematic acute obstruction. So the last type is the strangulated obstruction, develops when circulation to obstructed intestine is impaired. So that means, and previous or everything are the simple obstructions. That means the bowel vascularity is intact. Okay, whereas strangulated obstruction means it is nothing but intestinal obstruction if the bowel vascularity is jeopardized or infarcted or decreased or almost lost. So when the vascularity is lost, so many changes will occur and the patient will go into sepsis. So strangulated obstruction will give rise to septic shock. So the causes of strangulation, like external, same. Some of the causes in the dynamic obstruction in the first chapter, in the first 2 or 3 slides we have discussed. Some of them will give rise to strangulation if they are not treated in as early as possible. For example, hernial orifices. So that means normal hernia is there. A reducible hernia is there. If you don't treat it early, what will happen? What will happen to reducible hernia.
Irreducible hernia.
Very good.
Or
so it may get it may get irreducible. If you don't tackle, it may go for obstructed. Still, if you don't tackle, it has not come to you, you are not able to, you have not seen the scrotum and inguinal areas, and you do not know the cause for all these things, it may go for strangulation. And likewise, adhesions and bands, they produce first the simple dynamic obstructions. But in late stages, all these things will give rise to strangulated obstructions. The same, valvulus and intercessors. So valvulus, when there is a twist, so early twist, so twist within 12 hours or 24 hours, there will be, blood supply will not be cut off. If it is prolonged, the blood supply will be cut off and the valvulated bowel will become gangrenous. So increased intraluminal pressure like closed loop obstruction and primary strangulation is due to mesenteric infarction. So emboli or thrombi in the superior or inferior mesenteric vessels, they can give rise to strangulated intestinal bowel, strangulated intestinal obstruction. So what happens once there is obstruction? So obstruction is simple obstruction. So there will be distension of the small intestinal loops because of the gas and fluid. So in that stage, at that stage, you have to relieve the obstruction. Otherwise, what will happen because of the distension? There will be venous compression. So then finally, there will be congestion and edema of the mucosal wall, and finally, arterial compromisation and strangulation and gangrene. So the simple dynamic obstruction is going for strangulated and gangrenous bowel. The only thing is, this is the simple is becoming complicated because of the negligence by anybody, either by the patient or by the treating doctor. So that means very careful, important diagnosis you have to make out. Early diagnosis you have to make out. So once there is strangulation, there will be proliferation of the bacteria. Proliferation of the bacteria, so there will be transmigration of the bacteria. So that bowel wall will be up. So the bacteria which are present in the mucosal layer, they transmigrate through the wall. They will come to the outer surface, that is onto the serosa. So once it has come to the serosa, it will touch the peritoneum, give rise to peritonism and peritonitis. Okay, and those proliferated bacteria will produce toxins which may be absorbed into the circulation, giving rise to septic shock. So this is what happens after strangulation. So this is an example showing the strangulation, how strangulation can occur. Can anybody tell what hernia it is? It is a strangulated hernia as an example. So now,
Richter's hernia.
It is hernia.
Richter's hernia. Richter's
hernia. No, Richter's hernia. Richter's hernia. ఇప్పుడు ఇది బవల్ లూప్ ఓన్లీ సర్కంఫరెన్స్ అవుతుంది కానీ ఇక్కడ ఇది బవల్ లూప్ అంతా వెళ్తుంది కదా రిక్టర్స్ అంటే
పార్ట్ ఆఫ్ ద బవల్ కదా వెళ్ళింది
పార్ట్ ఆఫ్ ది బవల్ కాదు పార్ట్ ఆఫ్ ది సర్కంఫరెన్స్ ఆఫ్ ది బవల్ పార్ట్ ఆఫ్ ది సర్కంఫరెన్స్ ఆఫ్ ది వాల్ ఆఫ్ ది బవల్ అది ఏమిటి అప్రిషియేట్ మీకు రిక్టర్స్ ఇప్పుడు ఇక్కడ ఇక్కడ చూడు ఈ పార్ట్ ఎప్పుడైనా పార్టే కదా వెళ్ళేది ఇంటూ ద హెర్నియా టు లూప్స్ will enter into the hernial sac as contents. Kada? And band kuda oka loop nunchi untadu gaani entire not from entire small intestine. Okay. You see, this is no. Idi em hernia ante it is normal hernia only. That means the loop of small intestine has gone into the as content. See, idantha loop. You remember Richter's hernia ante ఈ లూప్ అంతా ఇక్కడే ఉంటుంది ఇక్కడే ఉండి సర్కంఫరెన్స్ అంటే ఇది అర్థమైందా దిస్ ఇస్ ది సర్కంఫరెన్స్ కదా డయామీటర్ సర్కంఫరెన్స్
సార్ పాయింటర్
పాయింటర్ ఇక్కడ నాకు తెలియలేదు అమ్మా ఓకే ఇప్పుడు ఇక్కడ తెలుస్తుందా ఇప్పుడు నేను ఈ పెన్ పెట్టిన కనపట్టలేదా
No,
Pen
sir.
to chupis na kan? No, na? Okay. Okay, it is, the question is, it is not rectus hernia, it is normal hernia only. Where is the hernia? What is the site of the hernia? By looking at the diagram, you can see.
Umbilicus.
Don't they have? Huh? Chodan dam, ma, yeh undi kada skin no, abdominal wall lo weakness. Akarache hernia.
Superficial inguinal ring nunchi, inguinal. Umbilical.
Ah, umbilical kuda kadu, it is, yes, umbilical you can say, but it is above the umbilicus, what is the common hernia?
Epigastric.
Epigastric hernia, probably this is a epigastric hernia. Umbilicus aite ikkada umbilicus bomma isundhi vaadu. Kada? So this is abdominal wall weakness in the linea alba. So this is a epigastric hernia, into which, this is all small bowel, only part of this, this loop has gone. The entire loop is going, you see? Entire loop is going as a content. Whereas in rectus hernia, only this, everything will be in the abdomen. Only the circumference, a part will be going into the sac. With the rectus hernia, these are special hernia chupistanu. So this is probably the epigastric hernia, which has gone into the, ekkada unta the drawing tools lo untadu adi. Pen, no? Ah. You see, this entire loop is going, into the hernia. That is weakness in the abdominal part. This is probably epigastric hernia, please remember. Whereas in rectus hernia, this in the loop, this is the circumference, only this part will go, only this part will enlarge. This will be here only. Whereas you can see, as extension, the entire loop is moving into the hernial sac. You see, the entire loop is moving into the hernial sac, which has got strangulated because of. Because of this tightness, because the ring is very tight in this case, probably it has got strangulated. So what is the treatment in this case? You relieve the obstruction here because the ring is very narrow. Since the ring is very narrow, that means the defect in the linea alba is very narrow. The entered bowel has become dilated and congested because of the narrow neck. The blood supply is obliterated or jeopardized. So the treatment is, in this case, the relief of the obstruction here, and you see the viability of the bowel here, and if it is viable, you push into the abdomen and you do hernioplasty. And if it is strangulated, not viable, you resection, do end-to-end anastomosis, push into the abdomen, you do herniorrhaphy or hernioplasty, depending on the necessity. What
happened?
So the clinical features of strangulation, I already told you, constant and severe pain, tenderness, will, the rigidity will be there. Because the bacteria, the bowel is gangrenous with bacteria which has translocated from mucosa onto the serosa, which has touched the bowel, I mean the peritoneum, giving rise to peritonism in early stages. And if the bowel has got ruptured, that is perforated, then there will be frank peritonitis will be there. And the shock is due to, because there is peritonitis and there is bacterial involvement, the shock is due to septicemia, that is septic shock. Of course, you read this, the same thing. So when strangulation occurs in external hernia, for example, the inguinal hernia is there. What happens if he got strangulated? The lump becomes tense and tender. ఈ పదం రావాలి. In strangulated hernia, the hernia that is present will be tense and tender, irreducible, and there is no expansion of impulse. So there may be some erythema and skin changes might be there over the overlying skin. So the normal hernia is soft, right? The normal hernia is soft and reduced. So the obstructed hernia is again soft but not reducible. Whereas strangulated hernia is tense and tender, of course not reducible, and there will be no expansion of impulse. So these are the four characteristics of the strangulated hernia. Strangulated hernia important, right? Okay. The same thing in intestinal obstruction. You see this is the either umbilical hernia or epigastric hernia, which has entered the sac and it has got strangulated. And on opening this abdomen, you can see the small bowel and part of large bowel have entered into the epigastric or hernial sac, and which have got gangrenous. You see, you can see the difference, the gangrenous black bowels here. You see, part of the cecum is also gangrenous. You can see the normal cecum, the color. You can see the normal cecum or gangrenous bowels. So this is, you can see the small intestine, which is black. So this is a resected gangrenous small bowel. However, there are the differences between mechanical obstruction, strangulation, paralytic ileus. Because this is very important. Paralytic ileus, what is the common cause of paralytic ileus? Post-operative. Strangulation, the common is the previous in mechanical obstruction, which is not treated in as early as possible. So the same intestinal obstruction which is present earlier as dynamic or whatever it is, if it is not treated early, it may get strangulated. Okay, so this is mechanically simple obstruction. When the blood supply is lost, it is strangulated. Strangulated obstruction, of course, paralytic ileus is adynamic. These are all dynamic, but this is paralytic ileus is adynamic. You can just go through this table after this class in your leisure time. So the other important detail is closed loop obstruction. You can see this occurs when the bowel is obstructed at both proximal and distal parts. Both proximal and distal parts. And the classical example is, see, for example, this is the hernia. For example, this is the hernia. This is the neck of the hernia. And there is obstruction at the proximal loop and distal loop. See, proximal loop and distal loop. So when there is obstruction like this, this is a closed loop obstruction. So this is the cause which may get, it gets lot distended very much, may get strangulated. Okay, so this is a closed loop obstruction. And the classical closed loop obstructions especially occur in the colon. See, this is the colonic growth. What is this part here? What is it? Which part of the colon it is? This white is called growth. Chapanda, splenic flexure, kada? Splenic flexure. Transverse fold. Beginning of the transverse fold, splenic flexure. So there is a growth here.
Hepatic flexure, sir.
Ah, sorry. Yes. Yes, correct. It is a hepatic flexure. So hepatic flexure, and there is an obstruction here because of the growth, and this is the intact ileocecal junction. The ileocecal valve is intact. So there is a distance of a loop in between the growth and the intact ileocecal junction. So this becomes a closed loop obstruction. So what is the danger? It may dilate like anything, and it may get strangulated. It may get strangulated. Time on the. So it may get strangulated. So this is, these are the two examples. So in the hernia and in the hernia, which is commonly in the small intestine, and this is in the large intestine because of the growth in the anywhere. For example, the growth can be in the skin flexure. So then the when the ileocecal junction is ileocecal valve is intact, that means it's not allowing the fluids from the colon back into the ileum, then there will be a closed loop obstruction and this becomes grossly distended and it may go into strangulation perforation. So distended colon unable to decompress, you can see this is the loop which has entered, decompressed distal bowel. See this distal bowel, and proximal to the obstruction there may be obstruction, dilation, because this part is not going in, this part is not participating in the intestinal content circulation. Okay, so the distal proximal part will be dilated and distal part will be decompressed or flat or flash. So this is mainly, see, this is the adhesion causing the internal herniation, adhesions giving rise to intestinal obstruction. Okay, so when proximal and distal both are not obstructed, then there will be a closed loop obstruction. So distended colon unable to, and closed loop obstructions are very common in colon, that's why I have given as example. Distended colon unable to decompress itself into small bowel because of the intact ileocecal junction, and because of that there will be increased luminal pressure and impairment of blood flow in the wall, finally strangulation, necrosis and perforation. So once there is so much of there in the, once it is perforated or strangulated, the patient will have endotoxic shock, very serious conditions. So going to the investigations of, meet Japan in the beginning of the small intestinal topic, the small intestine heading lo cheppanu kada, the anatomy, physiology and investigation. So all the investigations are necessary. What is the main investigation, the investigation, the simplest investigation for intestinal obstruction, cheppandi? Ayyenda
contrast x-ray, barium
ileum, barium ileum
kaadu fine rasindi. For intestinal obstruction, remember, not for all the diseases of the small intestine, I'm not asking. For intestinal obstruction, the simplest and first investigation is
X-ray.
Plain X-ray. In more than 50 to 60 or 70% of the cases of intestinal obstruction, acute dynamic intestinal obstruction, can be diagnosed with plain X-ray. Likewise, for peritonitis due to perforation of a duodenal ulcer, you know, which is the commonest, the investigation is, the first line investigation is plain X-ray of the abdomen in erect posture, or X-ray chest PA view, including the both domes of diaphragm. Only the idea is to look for the gas in that case, whereas in this case, to look for the multiple distended bowel loops. సార్ వచ్చారా మన మెడిసిన్ క్లాస్ కి ఒక బొమ్మ చూపించేసి వెళ్తారు. సో దేర్ ఆల్ ది ల్యాబ్ ఇన్వెస్టిగేషన్స్. గోల్స్ ఆఫ్ డయాగ్నోసిస్ మీకు ఇవన్నీ పంపిస్తాను కదా, యూ గో త్రూ. ఓకే, నేను మళ్ళీ ఐ విల్ కంటిన్యూ ఇన్ ద నెక్స్ట్ క్లాస్. వాట్ ఈస్ టు బి సీన్ ఇన్ ది ప్లేన్ ఎక్స్రే. ఓకే, యూ కెన్ సీ ది స్టెప్ ల్యాడర్ ప్యాటర్న్. ఇది ఒక్కటి చెప్పండి, వాట్ ఈస్ దిస్?
కోలన్
అంటే స్మాల్ ఇంటెస్టైన్, ఇది
జెజన.
ఎస్, యు కెన్ సీ వాల్వులే కాన్వెంటిస్, వాల్వులే కాన్వెంటిస్ ఆర్ కన్సెప్టినా ఎఫెక్ట్. ఓకే, యు కెన్ సీ దట్ మీన్స్ దీస్ ఆర్ ది, దీస్ వైట్ లైన్స్ ఆర్ మ్యూకోసల్ ఫోల్డ్స, దీస్ మ్యూకోసల్ ఫోల్డ్స్ ఆర్ encircling the entire circumference of the bowel. Okay, this is a jejunal loop, that means the patient will be might be having somewhere in the ileum or distal part of the jejunum the obstruction, so the proximal jejunum is dilated. This is the typical jejunal loop, okay, with valvulae conventis. Okay, identity, what is this? Large intestine. Why do you say? Because the it is very much wide, and you can see the haustal. See, these haustal folds are not from one, is not completely encircling the lumen of the intestine. You see, it is disrupted here. Okay, these are the haustal folds. Whereas valvulae conventis, they will be throughout the circumference of the bowel. This is large intestine. They are called, what are they? Obstructions. Obstructions. And in the plain X-ray, you can see for any etiology. For example, in this case, the patient is having intestinal obstruction, but the patient is having, you can see, fecolits. See, fecolits in this area. What is the structure in this area? Vitiligo fossa, giving rise to fecolits. Appendix. Appendix, it's a common structure. Appendix lo fecolits undi. So the patient is having appendicitis, appendicular mass to which the bowels are got adherent, giving rise to intestinal obstruction. Okay, so what is the clue? The patient is having intestinal obstruction. There are fecolits in the right leg fossa in the area of appendix. So you can come to a reasonable conclusion that the cause might be due to appendicular mass or appendicular abscess. Okay. See, for example, in this plain X-ray, you can see the gallstone. This area is ileocecal junction area in the right leg fossa. So in the terminal ileum, there is a gallstone. Normally, gallstones will be somewhere here. See, this is in the gallbladder. This is in the gallbladder stone, whereas this stone is in the terminal ileum, giving rise to gallstone ileus. Gallstone ileus is nothing but intestinal obstruction due to passage of gallstone from the gallbladder into the small intestine. Okay, that is important short notes, gallstone ileus. The gallbladder చెప్పినప్పుడు చెప్తాను, and in special types of intestinal obstruction చెప్పినప్పుడు చెప్తాను. Okay, so with this, we are the plain, see, this is the aerodynamic. What are these loops again? Valvulae conventis. So they are the full circumference of the lumen of the intestine. Whereas this is a colon. See, at the lateral aspect, this is colon. In the colon, they are not up to the full circumference of the lumen. So in aerodynamic ileus, so I have given you the table difference between aerodynamic, that means paralytic ileus, and mechanical. So in paralytic ileus, you can see the gas in the colon also. So entire small and large intestine will got paralyzed. Whereas in intestinal obstruction, that is mechanical obstruction of the small bowel, the colon will be empty. The colon will be empty because that will be passed as flatus in the inferior stage. Okay, so this you have to remember. Of course, this is CT abdomen. You can read. I will give you this and barium study. And barium study is not necessary for all the cases. For example, if it is intersusception, this claw sign, claw foot appearance. And if it is carcinoma of the colon or small intestine, there will be apple core appearance of the colon. So this is the food chasana, amma. I will give you this presentation to you. Okay, Pawan?
Yes, sir.
I will give you, you go through the remaining slides. We will discuss in the next class. Right? Sir, okay. Medicine class start out. Right. Randi, sir. Yekkada end chesedi? How to end the recording? Stop your recording.